Good afternoon. We welcome all of you to the second webinar on Insolvency and Bankruptcy Code 2016. Today we have Mr. Anil Goyal, Founder Chairman, AAA Insolvency Professionals LLP, and Mr. Hemant Sharma, Insolvency Professional Advocate, Partner, Sastra Legal. This webinar is in continuation of our first webinar held on April 20th, 2017. Today's webinar will cover corporate insolvency resolution process and some practical cases. We welcome you, sir.
Thank you. Good afternoon, all the participants. I understand that the second series of this webinar was decided in the last webinar, which was on 20th of April. And this webinar is in continuation to the last interaction that I had with you. See, I believe there'll be many people who have joined afresh this time, who probably might have missed the last webinar. So I would actually give a little recap that what we discussed in the last webinar. We discussed the need of this insolvency and bankruptcy law. We also discussed how the stressed assets were being managed in this country before this. And we also discussed what are the options available now. We spent a lot of time on the belief that we have gathered amongst the professionals that this law is going to be really a fast-track law. We presented before the participants that various sections and various provisions in the code and the regulations which will ensure that this law would be implemented as per the timeline prescribed in the law. The timelines which actually have been very nicely being adhered to by the NCLTs also so far. We also discussed the provisions regarding malicious and fraudulent applications before NCLT, which is filed with an objective other than resolution of insolvency or liquidation. The application procedure was also discussed. Who can apply? When can apply? That was also discussed. Presently, what we think as if the person has been appointed as interim resolution professional. So we actually will take over from that stage of the CIRP. CIRP means corporate insolvency resolution process. So from today we actually will take it forward from the stage when the interim resolution professional has been appointed. So let me focus on first of all. So I have a presentation. I'm not sure whether you are able to see the presentation or not. So see, as per section 18 subclause C, interim resolution professional will constitute committee of creditors. The entire responsibility under the code is on the IRP for constitution of committee of creditors. And section 21(2) very precisely prescribe that the committee of creditors shall comprise only financial creditors. Now the financial creditors in this case can be banks and financial institutions, it can be NBFCs. Irrespective of whether the loan is secured or unsecured, the financial creditors are part of the committee of creditors. There can be unsecured loans from the parties, unsecured loans from the directors, their relatives, their associate concerns, and any other person who has given a loan to the company, any other person who has given a loan to the corporate debtor. See, in this case, it is very important to understand See, what is the definition of financial creditor? So for understanding the definition of financial creditor, we need to understand the definition of financial debt, which is clearly given in subclause 8 to section 5, the section which is giving all the definitions for this chapter. So in that particular section, the debt means, see, this financial debt is any money which is borrowed against interest. The definition there is, which is disbursed against the consideration for the time value of the money. Now, the time value of the money is something which is very important to understand. The time value means that the time that the money has been used by the corporate debtor, and there is a consideration related to the time. So that means there is a consideration related to the time, means like lower the time, lower consideration, higher the time, higher consideration. So that is called interest, or it can be called in any other manner, any other name, but it should have a time value of money. So that is what is called financial debt. It can be in the shape of bonds, it can be in the shape of notes, it can be in the shape of debentures, it can be in the shape of term loans by the banks and financial institutions. It can be even working capital, because in the working capital also the interest is applied based on the time that the money has been used by the corporate debtor. In the case of leases, there are two kinds of leases. One is an operational lease and one is a financial lease. In the case of financial lease, it is a financial debt. In the case of operational lease, it is an operational debt. The financial lease is where the amount which is like, this is totally defined. The company law is also defines the difference between the financial lease and the operational lease. The bill discounting, bill purchase, these are also kind of financial debt. Then forward contracts for the purchase of foreign currency, for purchase agreements, derivative transactions, all these are kind of financial debt. So once the financial debt is understandable, then it is very easy to understand then the financial creditor. The committee of creditor will be constituted by the financial creditor only. Now, there is a scenario that in any corporate debtor, the loan has been given by the directors, the loan has been given by the associate concerns, relatives of the directors, or any other person who is related to the management, related to the shareholders. So those people, they would definitely be part of the committee of creditors, but they will have no right to vote, participate, or discuss any matters in the committee of creditors. So when we are constituting the committee of creditors, then in that case, one is the financial creditor. Financial creditor with the definition that I've said. So, any related party to whom a corporate debtor owes a financial debt shall not have any right of representation, participation or voting in the meeting of committee of creditors. So, this is very clear, although they will be part of the committee, but they will have no right to vote. Now, as a financial creditor or as an interim resolution professional, you need to understand the other concept, that is the concept of voting share. In the committee of creditors, there is a concept of voting share of each member. Now, the voting share is determined based on the financial debt, based on the amount of financial debt. For example, the total financial debt based on the claims received by IRP is 100 crores. And one financial creditor has given a loan of 25 crores. So that means his voting share in the committee of creditor will be 25%. Similarly, the other financial creditors will also see the total amount of debt and divided by the total debt of the company, total financial debt of the company. So that will determine the voting share of each member of COC. See, in various cases, there is a possibility that the person has given a loan to the corporate debtor and person has also supplied goods and services to the corporate debtor. So in those cases, the financial debt would be considered separately, the operational debt would be considered separately. The financial debt will actually become part of the total financial debt of the company. The operational debt will become part of the total operational debt of the company. Voting share will be only based on the financial debt. It will not be based on the total debt. It will not include operational debt into the voting share. In any case, in case any operational creditor, the operational creditor assign his right to any other person. An operational creditor sells his rights to another financial creditor, so the operational creditor cannot get converted into financial creditor. Now, let me give an example to you. Party A supplied goods to the corporate debtor. So after the supply of the goods, he sold his debt to a financial institution or bank, which is called purchase of bills without recourse. So there are two kinds of purchase of bills. One is complete assignment with no recourse back to the supplier, and there is another one which is basically financing only with a recourse to the supplier. So with a recourse means, like, in case the customer doesn't pay, the financial creditor will have a right to recover from the supplier. And the other category is, in case the personal doesn't pay, the financial creditor will have no right to go to the supplier. So in the case of complete assignment with no recourse, it will continue to be a financial, it will continue to be an operational creditor, and it will be an operational creditor for the purpose of constitution of committee of creditors. So this has to be understood very clearly. The origin of the debt is very important. If the origin of the debt is operational debt, it will continue to be an operational debt. It cannot be converted into a financial debt, even if it is transferred to another other financial institution, even if the supplier has taken loan against that from any other financial institution. The operational creditor will always remain an operational creditor. So, in the case of consortium arrangements or in the case of syndicated facilities or in the case of issue of securities like debentures, so there is an option available. Normally in the case of debenture holders, the debenture trustee will actually become part of the committee of creditors. In the case of consortium arrangements, each member will have a right to be a part of the committee of creditors. In the case of syndicated facility also, each member will become part of the committee of creditors. So the member is only one. See, let us give an example. If it is a State Bank of India, and the State Bank of India has given loan to different units of corporate debtor and through different branches in the country. See, when it is a case of formation of committee of creditors, State Bank of India will be considered as one. However, the total amount of debt will be consolidated in one. So this will be considered as a total value of the financial debt, and according to the total voting share will be determined in this manner. See, in the committee of creditors, there is another option available. This is probably, I want to share with you that when this law was being drafted, this difficulty was apprehended that in coming years, in coming time, there may be a case that in a single day there are too many meetings of COC. So in that case, what will happen? Would it be possible for a senior person to go and participate into the COC? in one day a person cannot do more than a limited work. So this was also apprehended that there may be a possibility that in one day there are many COCs. So in that COC, I will actually take up in the next couple of slides that the voting has been prescribed in such a manner that it is really not necessary that the senior person should go and take a decision immediately. Because that is one reason the e-voting has been prescribed, that in case the discussion and everything has been, anyone can come and participate into COC. Even a junior officer can come and participate into COC. He can understand the other's view. He can understand the concept, issue, and then he can go back and discuss with the senior officers of the bank or financial institutions. Based on all the facts, then the financial institutions can take a decision, put up their notes, and take final approval within the next 48 and then there are then 24 hours, within the next 72 hours, and then opt for e-voting. So this has been very carefully drafted law, understanding the difficulty in future that the senior people will not be able to go to the COC meetings and decisions has to be taken. So they have actually given 72 hours time from the time it is discussed, from the time all the facts have been presented before the bank or the members, and the decision making. The decision making can take up within 72 hours of the presentation of all the facts and documents before the member of a COC. Then the second thing that they have also done, like in case the officer of the financial institution is not really conversant with the provisions of the code, he is also not very conversant with the issues, with the options available, and also like he is not an expert on technical issues. So each member can appoint a resolution, an insolvency professional officially, and the insolvency professional can also go along with the member in the meeting and take part in the discussions and make representations. So this is also one of the important provision. It has been actually, it has been made, the provision has been made to understand the future difficulties. See, this committee of creditor will take all the decisions in this corporate insolvency resolution process. The IRP or the RP, interim resolution professional or resolution professional, is only working as an agent of COC. However, the COC can take a decision if 75% of the voting shares have consented for a resolution. So if 75% of the voting share are not agreeable to the particular decision, that decision will not take place. So this is also, the entire power is with COC, but 75% voting share is important. It is mandatory for taking any decision. So there, this is one segment of the committee of creditors where the financial creditors are the members, because the company has taken loans. In the financial creditors, the creditors which are related to the management, related to the directors, related to the members, associate companies, those people would be the members, but they will not have any right to represent or vote in the meeting. Now let us talk about those companies where there are no financial creditors. That means that the company has not taken, the corporate debtor has not taken any loan. In fact, in this new regime of various startups, where the projects are being funded by venture capitalists, angel investors, in those companies, the maximum money is coming by way of share capital, equity share capital or preference share capital. And the other source of a capital, the other source of fund flow would be the operational creditor, the people, the parties, the persons who have supplied goods and services to the company. So in case there is no financial creditor, then let us look at who are the operational creditors. Now the operational creditor in this case, in the Insolvency and Bankruptcy Code, has been defined as one, persons who have supplied goods and services to the corporate debtor. Number two, workmen as defined under Industrial Dispute Act. Number three, employees working with the corporate debtor. Number four, the state government departments, central government departments, and local authorities, in case there is any amount due to them. So there are four kinds of operational creditors in a corporate debtor: goods and services, workmen, employees, statutory liabilities. All these will be collectively called as operational creditors. So in case there are no financial creditors, then the committee of creditors will only consist of operational creditors. And the code says that the total number of members will be 18 maximum. Maximum number of members in this committee would be 18. And those 18 would be largest operational creditors. Now in certain cases there may be a possibility that the government dues are the largest. So they also would become part of the COC. So 18 largest, and the list will include all the goods and services persons, taxes, workmen, employees. So the top 18, there will be a list of all the creditors, and then we will sort in the order of amount. So the largest 18 amount will be selected, and those people will actually become the members of the COC. They also have the same rights, same powers, and same obligations. See, when we say same rights, same power, same obligations, means that they also will be able to take a decision with the 75% of the voting share, and they will be able to take all those decisions which financial creditors are able to take. Now, see here, till now we have now constituted a committee of creditors with the members. Now let us see when the first meeting of the committee of creditors will be held. Regulation 17(1) says that it is the responsibility of the interim resolution professional to constitute committee of creditors and submit a report to adjudicating authority, means NCLT, on or before the expiry of 30 days from his appointment. Now he has been appointed, and within 30 days he has to submit a report that the constitution of the committee has been done, and the list of members will have to be submitted to the adjudicating authority within 30 days. And the second provision says, the section 22(1) and regulation 17(2) says that the interim resolution professional shall convene the first meeting of committee of creditors within 7 days of filing the report. So in total, this can be 37 days, but there is a little overlapping provision. So we are still considering that the first meeting will have to be done in 30 days, from within 30 days of the appointment of IRP. So in this first meeting, so this is a very important subject, very important matter which will be discussed, that will be whether the interim resolution professional is continuing as a resolution professional, or the committee of creditors have proposed to change his name with another insolvency professional. So in case there is a proposal to change, then the committee of creditor in the first meeting will decide that the interim resolution professional will be replaced by a resolution professional, a different insolvency professional. And accordingly, the other matters in the committee of creditors can also be discussed, like the appointment of registered valuers, the remuneration of interim resolution professional, and in case the resolution professional has been appointed, then the remuneration of a resolution professional also. So in the first meeting of committee of creditors, so there are many important matters that has to be discussed, including the very, very important issues of continuation of the business of the corporate debtor. This is the responsibility of the interim resolution professional and resolution professional to keep the company, to keep the corporate debtor as going concern. It is the responsibility of the resolution professional to maintain the continuity of the business of the corporate debtor. So any permission, any approval, any expenditure which is required for this objective, that should appear in the very first meeting, so that accordingly the steps are taken to assure that the business is not killed. Steps are taken to assure that whatever funds are required to maintain the continuity of the business are arranged, and it will also become the responsibility of the COC to agree to the suggestions of the IRP if those suggestions are focused on continuity of the business. So it is the responsibility that he should present his suggestions, that the business otherwise will be killed. The committee of creditors will have to take a decision about the arrangement of funds, about recruitment of certain persons, whatever could be the necessity, whatever could be the need for maintaining the continuation of the business, that should be discussed in the very first meeting of the COC. Now let us talk about this is the first meeting. In the first meeting, the IRP is replaced by the RP, or IRP is continued as RP. Now, as far as the subsequent meetings of the COC is concerned, there is no limit in the code or in the regulations on the number of meetings that is that a RP can have. So the only requirement is that the RP will have to give a notice of at least 7 days for convening a meeting of COC, and that notice of 7 days can also be reduced to 24 hours in case all the members give consent. But in case there is even one member which is not giving consent, then this notice of 7 days would be required, or any notice period which is approved by COC would be okay, but not less than 24 hours. In case the committee of creditors or any member of committee of creditors want to convene a meeting, then they can also direct a resolution professional to convene a meeting of COC. But for making this request to RP, the minimum voting share of those members should be at least 33%. So in case 25%, in case members having 25% voting share ask RP to convene a meeting of COC, he may not agree. That is not obligatory on him to agree. See, the other part is very important part is, like, in the manner the meeting of COC will be conducted. The first condition is that the meeting will be conducted in person, and also there will be an option of conducting the meeting by video conferencing or other video and audio means. So what I have seen is, like, in case in the notice itself, when the IRP is giving a notice for the meeting, the IRP need to ask if any member is interested in participating in the meeting in video conferencing, then the member should inform the RP so that the adequate arrangements are made for video conferencing. But in case nobody says that I would be participating through video conferencing, then the meeting will take place in person, and that meeting will be valid meeting. But it would be definitely an option available with all the members of COC that the meeting can take place through the means of video conferencing, or it can also, anyone can participate through video conferencing. But in case no requirement comes, then the meeting will still be valid and meeting will held in person. And it is very clear under section 24.2 and regulation 24.1 that the resolution professional will conduct the meeting and he will be the chairperson of the meeting. But this chairperson will not have any casting vote. This chairperson is not even having a voting right. But then he would be conducting the meeting, and the name that has been given in this code is that he would be chairing the meeting. So for each meeting of committee of creditors, the resolution professional is under obligation to send a notice to following parties. One, each member of the COC. Two, each member of the suspended board of the corporate debtor. Three, some of those operational creditors or their representatives. I am saying representatives in the case of workers, or in case of employees, it is also possible that they can represent through their representative. But the only condition is that they should at least be 10% of the total debt of the company. I would like to give an example here. I had given an example here that the financial creditors were 100 crores. Now think of a situation that in a company there are 50 crores of operational creditors also. So the total debt is 150 crores. So in this case, in case there is a operational creditor, or there is a group of workmen or group of employees who have a total debt of more than 10% of 150. So that means in case there is a total debt of more than 15 crore, either due to employees collectively or workmen collectively, or any one operational creditor. So they also would be invited for the meeting. They would also get the notice for the meeting. However, the operational creditors have no right to vote in the meeting. Similarly, members of the suspended board of the corporate debtor also have no right of voting. They have no right to participate, discuss in the meeting. Primarily, the COC would be governed by financial creditors, and in case financial creditors are not there, then largest 18 operational creditors. So the power center in the entire corporate insolvency resolution process is either financial creditors, in case they are available, they are existing. In case they are not existing, then operational creditor. So there is also a provisions regarding how the notice would be served. So it is stipulated that the notice should be served at least 7 days before the before the day of the meeting, which can be reduced to 24 hours if approved by COC, and that approval has to be in writing, and then the notice has to be in writing. It can be given by hand delivery or it can be given by post. See, like, while there is a provision that the notice can be delivered by hand delivery or notice can be given by post, there is a mandatory provision that the notice also would be served electronically, mandatory. So that means that the mail is a must on the email address which is last available with the RP, that on that particular mail it has to be sent. No, like, the actually the law has gone in such a detail, the regulations have gone in such a detail that they have even prescribed the manner that the email can be sent. They have even prescribed that the email can be sent as a text. They have also prescribed that the email can be sent by way of an attachment. And when we talk about attachment, they are saying that it can be even it should be PDF or any non-editable format. And even it is also prescribed that in case the email is not possible, in case the attachment is not possible, then there is a possibility of providing an electronic link, and you click that link and you see that notice. So there are three ways of giving notice electronically besides the by hand delivery or by post delivery. So this is the kind of detailing which has been done in the code and regulation, and it is also very specifically mentioned there what should be mentioned in the subject line and what should be the contents of the notice and what kind of detail would be given regarding place, time, and what kind of detail would be given whether the video conferencing is required or not. Even the details of e-voting will have to be incorporated in the notice. It has to be very well clearly mentioned in each notice that in case all the members would not be present, no decision will be taken in the meeting, and the voting will shift to e-voting. But in case all the members of COC would be present in the meeting, then e-voting is not required. But in case all the members of the COC are not present in the meeting, then the voting will shift to e-voting, but voting is must. Without voting, either in person or in electronic, e-voting, it is a must. So even the resolution professional has been guided how to maintain the records of emails sent, how to maintain the records of notices sent, which way the records will be kept, which way the video conferencing records will be kept. So these are all very, very specific instructions, specific guidance, specific regulations which has been given in the code and regulations. And the objective of all this is that complete transparency, complete documentation, and complete fairness in the CIRP regime. Now, it is also prescribed that the member actually can attend the meeting through a representative. However, the resolution professional must get the information, prior information about the person who is attending and the identity of the person who is attending. It is only prescribed so that the resolution professional is able to verify the person who is attending the meeting. Then the notice must contain the agenda. Now, there are two parts of the agenda. One, the list of matters to be discussed at the meeting, then the list of issues to be voted upon a meeting. Now see, there can be various matters which should be discussed with the committee of creditors, and these matters can be what has happened in the past after the last meeting, what have been the development on various matters which are pending for the which are pending under CIRP. Any development that you would like to inform to COC, and then the matters where the voting is required, those matters will be separately listed. See, all the copies which are relevant for the matters to be discussed, that would be
in this context. Actually, one Mr. Bridge Kalra, he is asking what can be the probable agenda for the first meeting and the subsequent meeting for the committee of creditors.
So we have a question now from
Mr. Bridge Kalra.
So what kind of
what are the probable agenda?
So let us try to understand one. The first and foremost will be the information to the COC, like the matters which has to be discussed. Let us say starting from the publication of notices. I believe all the notices which are published in the newspaper should be placed before the COC along with the full newspaper for them to verify whether the publication was done correctly or incorrectly. Two, appointment of registered valuers. It is not simply an appointment of registered valuers. The matter actually should be all the documents, the basis on which the registered valuers were appointed, selected, that basis also should be discussed with the COC. Three, the remuneration payable to the registered valuers should also be the matter of approval. The remuneration of IRP is also supposed to be one item where actually it should be part of the agenda. The whether the IRP will continue or the IRP will have to be replaced is also one of the agenda. Placement of information memorandum before the COC is also one of the agenda, and this is very important agenda because the IRP is actually working very hard on this. IRP is ready with the information memorandum except for the last three clauses.
So should it be placed in the first meeting?
It has to be placed in the first meeting. It has to be placed in the first meeting, and information memorandum. So in the first meeting, there is also very important part because all the members will come and participate in the first meeting, and everyone will ask for a copy of the information memorandum. Every member should be informed beforehand that I need an undertaking from each member before IRP hands over the information memorandum to any member. So all the financial creditors are supposed to give an undertaking. In my next slide, I will actually, when I will come to information memorandum, I will actually clarify that with that the undertaking is also one of the very important part, and that should also be part of the notice that everyone should send the undertaking before he shares the information memorandum to everyone. So I think these are the broadly.
It's like a non-disclosure.
So that is the undertaking is regarding the non-disclosure kind of a undertaking where. The information which is now being provided in the information memorandum would not be misused for any other purpose other than preparation of a resolution plan. It would not be used for the insider trading. And the other undertaking is that you will not share this information memorandum with any other person without taking this kind of undertaking again at yourself. So this is the kind of undertaking. So these are broadly the agenda items of the first meeting. And any other question on this?
It is relating to constitution of committee of creditors. A couple of questions are there.
We can take up the constitution.
Mr. B.K. Sharma, he is writing how the representatives of depositors and debenture holders will be appointed to be included in the committee of creditors.
So normally in the case of debenture holders, they are having debenture trustees. So those debenture trustees would represent on COC as one of the member. In the case of depositors, they will also have a option to individually represent, or they will have the option of represent through a representative, through a collective action of their own. But as far as the debentures are concerned, it is very clear that the debenture trustee will represent on behalf of the debenture holders.
And Ms. Jane, she is asking what would be the constitution of committee of creditors in case of only one financial creditor in the company.
So this is very clear. Even if there is one financial creditor in a company, that committee will consist of only one person. There will be other invitees. The invitees would be all the members of the suspended board of directors, and there will be another invitee in case there is an operational creditor who is actually having a total debt which is not less than 10% of the total debt of the company. So those would be invitees. One person, one financial creditor will be actually taking a decision, and the minutes would be prepared by RP and the decisions can be taken. So I already have explained to you that the voting can be done by a person. And in case any one member is missing, then the voting will shift to e-voting. The process and manner in which the e-voting is being done presently, there is a service being provided by NSDL. There is a portal on which e-voting facility is available against a charge. You can hire that facility, circulate that link, and before you circulate that link, for each resolution, you will have to present a resolution, and then after that there is a option of saying yes, no or abstain. So each member will actually go to that link of NSDL or any other company who may come up with the e-voting facility will read each and every resolution, and for each and every resolution there will be a separate voting, yes, no and abstain. So then for after each and every resolution that you vote for, and then finally you submit that. So after everyone submits, after the expiry of the 24 hours, this e-voting will be open for 24 hours. After the time is finished, after the time lapses, the automatic result will be out whether the resolution has been passed or not. Since the voting shares are already fed into the NSDL portal, so it will actually give you a detail whether the resolution has been passed or not. So the other important question is, whenever we talk about meetings, there is another question which is regarding the quorum at the meeting. So in this case, Regulation 22 prescribed that the quorum of the meeting is 33%. But then this is a very, very important law. This is very, very care. This law has been drafted very carefully. So the 33% of the voting share is the quorum present in person. In case even 33 voting share people are not there in the meeting, the meeting can automatically stand deferred, adjourned for the same time, same venue next day. And in case in the next day also, if the quorum is not present, the COC can take decisions. The COC can take decisions, but then what is important is, in case the people are not available, then it has to shift on VE voting. In case 100% of members are not available, then the meeting would take place, but the voting will shift to e-voting. So even if the quorum is 33%, although there is an option with the COC can actually say that in this CIRP, the quorum is now increased to 50%. And there may be a possibility that in some cases the quorum is 50%. The COC decides that the quorum will be 50%, and especially in those cases where there are only two financial creditors and both are having almost 50% shares, so they can even decide that the quorum will be 60% in this case, so that no one person can come and have a meeting and take a decision. Although there is another protection of e-voting. In case both the members are not available, the e-voting. But still, they have made it a provision that it can be increased by the COC from upward of 33%, but not downward. So in case of adjourned meeting, whether the quorum is available or not quorum is available, the meeting will take place and meeting will take decisions. The meeting will continue and it will shift to e-voting. So why it is not important, why it has been kept as that the quorum in this adjourned meeting is not important? Because the meeting is only symbolic. Decisions are being taken on e-voting. So it is not important whether the people are actually coming in person or not. The only important part is that they should actually understand the issues and they can even resort to e-voting also. But then the voting is must. So there is no possibility in future somebody can say that I had no knowledge of this particular decision being taken by COC. So this has been very clearly, transparently covered under the code and regulations. So there are also provisions in case somebody is participating in the meeting through video conferencing. Though video conferencing, there are various prescribed parameters regarding the acceptable video conferencing system. It should actually, see, like that is something which is keeping in mind the safety and security of the data, keeping in mind the preserving that meeting as a record, and in future, in case need be, presenting before any authority. So with this objective, there are guidelines like what kind of video conferencing would be acceptable. So, like this is the responsibility of the resolution professional to conduct the meeting in his capacity as the chairman of the meeting. The normal process of the meeting should be, when he conducts the meeting, the first and foremost should be that he should actually technically he should take a roll call of all the participants attending the meeting. He should make sure whether 100% of the members are present or not, in case 100% of members are not present. And he should also understand, like, who is attending, what is his name, what capacity he is attending, whether he is also having along a resolution professional or not. In the case of video conferencing, he is also supposed to take a roll call. He is also supposed to ask somebody that from where, which station he is participating. So all this is something which is a matter of record that he should understand, he should kept, and will be part of the records of the minutes. See, then the resolution professional will declare whether the quorum is complete or not. In case the quorum is complete, then the resolution professional will present the matters one by one and will discuss the issues one by one. And in case it has to be a voting in person, there is a possibility of voting in person. But then there is, I haven't seen, like, unless everyone says that yes, there is no assent from everyone, 100% people were present there and the meeting has actually taken place, then e-voting is not required. But the evidence of 100% members being present there is their attendance record, and they, since they, when they participate into the meeting, they sign a attendance register along with their name, their authority and the member they are representing. The immediately when this meeting finishes, in case 100% members are available there, that means that all the resolutions are passed or failed, minutes will be prepared immediately and it will be circulated within 48 hours. Now, the second situation is that the 100% members are not available, so the voting shifts to the e-voting. So even then also, immediately the resolution professional will prepare minutes, and after preparation of the minutes, will circulate the minutes along with the e-voting links, along with the matters which is already discussed in the meeting and the matters where the voting is required. So the members of COC will receive minutes, will receive the discussions in the meeting, will receive link, will log on to the link and will vote for each resolution.
There
so this is this. I think there is a question.
There are a couple of queries. They wanted to clarify on voting share.
See, voting share is very clear. Like, let us talk about the financial creditor only. I said the financial creditor, based on their claims, the IRP has made a total of claims, and the total of claims is 100 crores, for example. And then he will see the amount claimed by each and every person, amount verified by IRP, and finally amount determined by IRP. What we are talking about is finally amount determined by the IRP. So let me repeat, the claims received, claims verified, amount determined. So the amount finally determined by IRP is the amount which will form the part of total financial debt of the company. Financial debt is 100 crore, amount determined for each person is different. So the percentage of the total amount due for each member as divided by the 100 is the percentage in the voting share. So in case there are three members, one is having 20 crores of debt, the other is having 50 crores of debt, so this becomes 70%. So these two 70% people will not be able to take a decision unless the other person with 6 crores is also joins them. So 20 plus 50, they become 70%. So these 70% people will not be able to take a decision. So the other person who is also having 6 crores, he will have to join them to take a final decision on any particular resolution. So this is the voting share.
And there are some queries relating to interim resolution profession. Should we address it?
Yes,
now?
We can address.
So when does the 30-day tenure starts? Whether it's from the receipt of NCLT order or from the date of order appointing him?
See, there are two situations. In most of the cases, you might have seen the adjudicating authority has appointed IRP within the same order in which the CIRP commencement is approved. So in case this IRP is appointed within the same order, then that is the date of commencement of CIRP, and that is also the date of start of 30 days period. Now the second situation is that this, in that order of the adjudicating authority for commencement of CIRP is not having an appointment of IRP because the appointment was not, the name was not proposed by an operational creditor. Or, the name was proposed, but the name was not approved by the board. So, in that case, that adjudicating authority will have 14 days time with it for appointment of IRP. So, that means whenever the IRP is appointed, that would be the day to start 30 days period for IRP. So, these are two situations. Okay.
And there is a query, if an IRP is appointed on Friday, then what will be the third day for issuing public announcement?
See, application to adjudicating authority rules, it is very clearly mentioned that in case we are talking about the days, the day of the event is excluded. The day of the event is excluded, that means the Friday is excluded from the day. So, that means the first day would be Saturday and then Sunday and then it will be Monday. So, according to my understanding, the weekends are not excluded in the days. The weekends are part of the number of days, may it be 14 days, may it be 30 days. So, there is no such judgment so far that the 14 days or 30 days or 7 days will be calculated based on the working days of working days. So, it is not based on working days. The only thing which is mentioned in the rules is the day of the event is excluded. So, the Monday would be the third day.
Can I take CIRP initiation against the time barred date?
As far as the time barred date is concerned, first of all, if it has already been decided by any court that the debt is time barred, then it is not a question of default. The debt has already been declared as time barred by any court. Then it is not a fit case for filing an application for CIRP. Now, let us come to the second possibility. That possibility is that someone thinks that the debt is time barred. It is only somebody's observation that somebody's might see them. Then it is a matter of adjudication whether the debt is time barred or not. So, in case of adjudicated time barred debt, the CIRP option is not available. In case of disputed time barred debts, I am not sure the NCLT will go into the details of time barred. The NCLT will not consider all these applications till the time this time barred issue is settled outside the NCLT. So, in case it is something which is very, very important, so NCLT will say this is not my duty to handle the time barred issue. NCLT is only handle the debt is there or not.
And there is a question, what kind of liability can come on insolvency professional and what are the probable protections and how does he manage the potential liability?
See, there is a specific provision in the code. I think I can see in the book, or I have it in my other presentation, which protects IP.
19, section 19.
Let us see, it is 19.
Can move an application.
So, there is protection to IP that any non-compliance. This is different. Any non-compliance by the corporate debtor before the appointment of IRP, that would not have any impact on the IRP or RP. But any non-compliance, any violation, any criminal offense done by the IRP or RP, that is separate issue. But now, in the case of a corporate debtor, in case of any non-compliance is done before his appointment, that he is totally protected. Secondly, internationally, what we have read so far, that the biggest liability will come on insolvency professional, and that would be regarding killing a business. In case an insolvency professional has failed to maintain the continuity of the business, then the corporate debtor or the management can sue insolvency professional that he has not done his job diligently, and because of those negligences the company has suffered losses as he could not continue the business within those reasonable boundaries, within those simple efforts that he was supposed to make, and he did not make those efforts, or he took some decisions which killed the running business of the organization, corporate debtor. So this is one liability which actually can be a little larger. Or other liabilities are, I don't foresee any other liability which is important.
And during moratorium period, when an employee resigns, or employees or management level people, if they are terminated, then what is the impact? Should it require approval of committee of creditors? Or
no, it is like, see, like once we say that the insolvency resolution professional is now has taken the custody of the business, and he is also responsible for management of the business of the corporate debtor. Once he is responsible for the management of the corporate debtor, there is a possibility that he might say that these 20 employees of the company are not required, and these 20 employees of the company are actually, it's a financial obligation, financial load on the company's finances, fund flows, and company will not be able to retain them. So then there is a possibility that he can actually terminate the services of those people. Those termination will be a normal termination, as if any company can do during the continuation of any business, that will not have any discharge over and above a normal discharge available to any corporate debtor for termination of services. There is no exemption for any termination during CIRP process. But that, yes, in case of any termination, I understand it that it should be discussed, minuted in the COC, because he is actually working as an agent of the COC. He should actually discuss, share with the COC, where the management is also there, and if there is any dissent by the management, that also can be recorded. Yes, this kind of decisions are not good. So this is what I feel, is that yes, IRP can take a decision of terminating employees with the approval of COC. It should be with the approval of COC. I am not saying that it is mandatory, but I am saying that it should be with the approval of COC. Okay. It is not mandatory, but. Okay.
If related party has 30% of total share of debt, then how does 75% of voting share will be calculated?
No, the related party debt amount is not calculated in the total debt. When I was talking about 100 crore, let us continue the same example. The related party is over and above this 100 crore. We have only considered those financial creditors which are not related parties. So those are outside that total debt definition.
In fact, there are more than two queries requesting you to clarify on the disputed debt, because there are NCLT orders regarding the disputed debt. So
no, see, this, there is a like, I can only give an example of disputed debt, because see, like, once we say that the under section 8, the operational creditor will give a notice to the corporate debtor that this is the invoice which is due from you, and the operational creditor may revert within 10 days. And what the corporate debtor can revert? One, that there is a dispute regarding this invoice. Two, that this invoice has already been paid. So in case any of these two is okay, and this is like then the application before adjudicating authority by an operational creditor would not stand. Now, and see, in the first is like there is a dispute. Now, in that case, the dispute has to be pending before any court or before any arbitration proceedings. The judgment of Uttam Galva is very clear. In that particular case, the Justice B.S.V. Prakash Kumar has very clearly held that the dispute has to be present before the notice is given, before the notice under Section 8 is given. So the notice under Section 8 was given in that case on day 1. On day 2, the corporate debtor actually filed a case before Bombay High Court, saying that there is a dispute regarding these invoices. So it was very clearly held by Justice B.S.V. Prakash Kumar that this particular dispute is an afterthought. See, while I am saying so, there are judgments which actually are saying, based on the facts, which are very clear that the dispute was there, and the dispute was actually apparently, there are many evidences that the dispute were there. The documentation before the operational creditors were not even complete. There were no purchase order, and the invoice was also not completely made. The delivery of the goods were also not evidenced. So in these cases also, like, I mean, see, they simply by presenting an invoice doesn't mean that the operational creditor has got a right to start in a CIRP for any person. So like in case the documentations are not complete, and then and also there are various other evidences that yes, there was a dispute, and this, so those disputes can have been considered by certain benches of NCLT, but I have not seen that it actually means little injustice to anyone. I think so far whatever decision has been taken, it has been taken one that the person is filing a suit on the very next day. That means the intention is very clear that he is trying to create a dispute without having any other evidences of dispute prior to this notice. This is one case. The second case is there are other instances, there are other evidences which are actually saying a lot about an existing dispute, but the dispute is not pending before any court or before any arbitration proceedings. In those cases, in case any NCLT bench has taken a view that this is also a dispute, so this is also not an injustice. The only thing which is important is that in all cases it should be justice, and the justice should be that yes, there was an invoice which was due, and it has to be paid. In case it has not been paid, the application under section 9 should survive.
This is for Mr. Anil and Mr. Hemant. What are the practical challenges that you face when you take up the role as interim professional or resolution professional?
The practical challenges for an IRP, for an RP, are many in fact. The first practical challenges are the capacity of IRP or RP. Think of a situation that a case is actually a very large case where there are lot many creditors and there are lot many receivables on the other side of the balance sheet. I have a case with me where the total number of debtors are 147 and the amount due from those debtors are about 300 crores. It is my obligation that I should actually understand whether these receivables are genuine or these receivables are not really recoverable. So in that process, for the purpose of determination of liquidation value, I will at least write letters to all those receivables. When I will write all those letters to all those receivables, 147 people will keep coming to your office with their documents, with their records, and they will actually try to tell you that this money is not really payable, this is a fake, this we have already paid. So this is one difficulty, which is a practical difficulty of capacity. On the other hand, in case of operational creditors or the financial creditors, is the number of operational creditors giving claims, number of financial creditors giving claims, and then verification of all these documents for a larger case where the financial creditors are also many and then the operational creditors are also many. See, what is happening presently is that presently in whatever number of cases we have seen, the public is not really aware of that they have to see and they have to file their claims. After some time, you will see that the financial newspapers in this country will actually have one column which will every day give a news of any company which has filed CIRP. You will see that the every business person in this country will look at that column and then they will see that whether his interest is being impacted in any case or not. In case he read a name where he is supplying some goods or services, he immediately will start filing the claims. So the IRP or RP will have number of claims and the time is very short. So this is one thing which is a practical difficulty of having that kind of capacity, having that kind of human resources, so that you are able to verify all the claims, you are able to attend in person to everyone, you are able to understand the documents of each financial creditor and operational creditor, you are able to ask them for the document, and you are able to take a decision. This is where you are at actually taking a decision. You are the adjudicating officer in this manner, that you actually are approving or disapproving a claim. You are determining the value of a particular claim. So this is the largest difficulty. I am not saying that the taking custody of a particular corporate debtor is a difficult part. Taking custody of a corporate debtor is a little lesser than this difficulty that I am saying, that you have to handle 20, 30 people every day in your office with different kinds of problems, with different kinds of records, with different kinds of evidences, and then there has to be human resources available with you who actually can understand, and also that you can trust upon them. If somebody is saying, presenting before you that yes, this claim is okay, this claim is valid, maybe that he is saying it because of some connivance or because of his misunderstanding about the document, but then the responsibility is yours because you have accepted this claim. Ultimately, your assistant makes a mistake, that is not an excuse. You actually have to be responsible. Yes, I accepted this claim. So the most important part is this. Then the taking custody of a particular corporate debtor. See, my opinion about taking custody of a corporate debtor is very simple. First and foremost is that you actually should calculate, because see, you have a section in your favor where you can actually write a letter to the income tax department that whatever in bank accounts that, because see, nowadays in the income tax return, all the bank accounts of a particular assessee is supposed to be declared. You can write a letter narrating your power and narrating the obligation of the income tax officer that all the bank accounts of that particular corporate debtor should be disclosed to you under section so and so of the Insolvency and Bankruptcy Code, because there is an order of the NCLT and you are appointed as IRP in this case. Once you have the information about the all the bank accounts of that particular corporate debtor, then you can write letters to all the corporate debtors and say that all there is no debit possible after this, and I would be the only person operating these accounts, or the person I would authorize for operations of these accounts. So first and foremost is that the financial power of the existing management is taken away. Second is that you actually have to send your people, in case you have human resources, you have to send your people at the all places where there are assets or there are stocks. So you take videography of those places, and in case possible you take inventory of the stocks, you take pictures, and that's it. You see, let the everything continues. You don't have to put your lock and key everywhere. You don't have to put your people everywhere. You don't have to put your security everywhere. It depends upon the circumstances. In case there is a hostile environment, that is a different. In case there is no hostile environment, that's a different. So the in case of no hostile environment, then it is possible that you actually have meetings with those promoters, you discuss with them the benefits of CIRP, the way they actually can resolve the insolvency, the way the company can turn around, the way they might even get lot of waivers of operational obligations, operational liabilities, or even statutory liabilities. This is all a matter of educating the promoter. Once the promoter is educated, then he will actually become your friend and he will start actually discussing the business with you. And this is what is custody, because in case you take the financial power with you, you take the inventory of the stock, you take the inventory of the fixed assets, you verify books of account, you put your own person there on the books of account and on operations on day-to-day basis. This is what is custody. So this is a little easier than handling the claims and receivable part of it.
Yes, Lakshmi, what Mr. Goyal has said, that is also equally correct, but the practical problem which I have been faced in the verifying the claims to determine the amount, because when one of the case I faced a problem, like Mr. Goyal said, yes, our job as an IRP to verify the claims to determine the amount, and here the provision of the 10% of the OC if having the total debt of that, so he is also, you have to send the notice to him for calling in the meeting. So in my case, I determined the value, but OC said no, because I reduced the value on the basis of the document which the company provided. But he said no, my value is this, if you do not send me the notice to me, so then I will file an application before the NCLT, and by saying so, that is that you are going biased against the operational creditors, against me, and not willing me to in involved into the meeting. Although I told him that the provision is this, this is the only meeting for the financial creditor. If I will send you the notice also, you cannot be able to vote into that meeting. But he said, no, your value, how can you reduce my value? The mindset of the public or the entrepreneurs in the large is that if suppose if you are claiming 100 rupees amount and I determined is 80, so he said you have to prove it how you can reduce my value from rupees 100 to 80. That is the first practical problem which Mr. Goyal rightly said, so that the awareness in the entrepreneurs or in the businesses, because the company in which I have been appointed is in Bhiwandi in Mumbai. And all the, because it's a textile and the units are closed, so people are not so well versed with this IBC. So you just communicate with them. The best, the process which I adopted to communicate with them, of course, for that your team should be there, or like he said, so that for the determine the claim of the debtors. Equally, I faced that problem also, because if I saw so many of debtors are there, so how should you get collect that money from them?
So approach, especially workers.
Absolutely. In my case, I am lucky that company is not operational, but that is your another difficulty in other cases also. The workers, to deal with the workers, because their mindset is that like someone has been appointed by the court, and now the everything or the custody into the hands of that fellow. So their job insecurity immediately comes into their mind. So we have to teach them and communicate with them that nothing has to be happened. Whatever the job they are doing, so they have to be continue with the same. Apart from that, the other like the custody of the assets. So suppose if I have been appointed and the order has come to into my hand and they said you have been appointed to take the custody, in the balance sheet it, they are showing some fixed asset, but not the schedule is there, because normally in ROC, if you see some of the company, they did not uploaded the complete balance sheet. Then you ask them where your assets are, then they will tell you these are my assets, land is there situated, and plant, machinery, of course you have to verify and all these things. I visited that place, they said this is the plot number, this is the this area, you take a custody of this. And that was a barren land. I said, where it is, there is no structure, where you have been function here. They said, no, data is, everything has been demolished. So you have to justify what, how can I take that plot is 6 or the some number is there, how to justify that? Then I appointed some legal person from there, the legal search that is available, if you appoint some local counsel from there, and he verified from the registry of that area. So that kind of problems are there. Challenges are there, I am saying, not problem, rather what is challenges.
Yes, certainly, like Hemant is very right in saying that the first challenge that he said is in respect of a claim of an operational creditor. I also said that this is the biggest challenge, that you understand a claim, understand the documents of the claim, convince the operational creditor or the financial creditor, have that kind of human resources. So this is the first difficulty. Second difficulty, he is also very right in saying, when we talk about custody of the businesses, it is actually difficult for a person to take custody of the businesses, to identify the assets which belongs to the corporate debtor. There is no list available with the with the NCLT, because there is only an order with you. See, presently as an IRP, I have only order which is saying that moratorium has commenced, CIRP has commenced, and Mr. So-and-so has been appointed with this address, has been appointed as the IRP in this case. That is the only document that you have.
Correct.
So once you are appointed as IRP, so it is only one order in your hand. So with this one order, I mean, it is actually very difficult to start. Where to start? How to start? You actually have only one thing, that is the publication. The public notice. You prepare the public notice. Within next 14 days, people will start coming to you. They will bring their own bunch of documents. Then you will start understanding that this company, whatever you can find about that particular corporate debtor on the public information domains, maybe MCA website or maybe Google or maybe any other company. Now there are other companies which provide data of even private limited companies, even if but they also have their source from the MCA side, and this especially it is difficult for those companies who are not compliant regarding filing of their returns before registrar of companies before on the MCA portal. See, this, that is one reason I said that as an IRP, you have power to reach out to the income tax officer of that corporate debtor, ask about the balance sheets, ask about the income tax returns, ask about the details of the bank accounts that the corporate debtor is having. Because the present income tax returns prescribes that all the bank accounts of a particular assessee needs to be mentioned there. I believe over a period of time, the assessing officers, the income tax officers will get appropriate instructions from their seniors to entertain these applications quickly. As of now, they have no knowledge whether they are under obligation or not. But in future, they would be having this kind of knowledge that we are under obligation to give this information in case the IRP is disclosing its identity, his identity. So, see, like, why it is easier for me, because I have handled in my last 14 years career 14,000 cases under SARFAESI Act. We have taken more than 2,000 physical possessions, physical custody of large to small business units, factories. So we understand the behavior of workers. We also understand the behavior of promoters. We actually have suffered under SARFAESI Act, where we couldn't take the possession for even 6 long years. And after making all the possible efforts, the promoters, the management keep on throwing hurdles in our way, and we are still outside the factory premises. We are still not inside the factory premises. But see, we also have powers under SARFAESI Act. Then we go to the local authorities, we seek an order in police. We seek an order to the police that the police will help us in taking custody. In this case also, we have powers. We can actually make an application to the NCLT, and NCLT will issue an order to the local authorities for extending necessary help, and that help can be providing police force, that help can be clearing the path from the group of workers who are not allowing us to go inside and take custody of the properties or assets of the company. So these are all provisions. It might take some time, but something which is better than nothing. In SARFAESI Act, we have actually waited for 8 years, 6 years, 10 years because of various stays here and there. But in this case, I mean, NCLT is a much larger court, much senior court. And the senior court order going to the local authorities, going to the police, I believe the action would definitely be there. So this is what our experience have been in taking custody. So that is one reason that I feel that the custody is not that difficult, but the back office is very, very important, because I am sure that the biggest responsibility lies in the back office. Nobody would be making a claim against you that there was stocks of 22 crores and you have eaten it away, unless there are circumstantial evidences that you actually took the custody, the security was also yours, and the stock was actually available worth 22 crores and you actually have reduced it to 2 crores, and also there are evidences that you removed it. Nobody is going to challenge you that the stock have actually declined because the balance sheet is showing 22, you are saying it is 2 crores only. So like, let us finish it, as far as the Committee of Creditor Party is concerned, there is only one slide left, and I would like to finish this because there are important parts later after. I see, like, immediately after this, then the second important part for a IRP or the RP is to prepare an information memorandum. After this information memorandum, I have a complete detailed presentation on what a resolution plan could be, what are the possibilities under the resolution plan, under the regulations, under the code, and the what would be the ultimate resolution plan order from the adjudicating authority. So I believe most of my financial creditor friends who are actually participating into this webinar, they would definitely be interested in understanding what are the options available under this code, whether one-time settlement is possible under this code, whether sale of assets is possible under this code without even sending the company to liquidation. So the resolution and liquidation. So there are 100 possibilities. Every possibility will be considered as a resolution plan. And there is only one thing which will be considered as liquidation, and that will be when we are dissolving the company. In case we are not dissolving the company, it is not a dissolution, it is not a liquidation. even if we sell the entire assets of the company to somebody else, but the corporate debtor as an entity continues after the resolution plan is approved. In the resolution plan, if the company is continuing with zero asset, with zero liability, it is still a resolution plan and not liquidation. So it is very clear the liquidation is only those where the company is actually being liquidated, the company is being dissolved. So let us completely, so there is one thing which is very, very important for all of us to understand, that the during the CIRP, the residential professional has powers, but limited powers. I'm saying it again, each important power, the resolution professional will require approval from COC, and that approval will come in case 75% of the voting share are voting in favor of that approval. So the first and foremost will be raising any interim finance in excess of the amount as may be decided by the COC in the meeting. So when we actually call the first meeting, I think there was a question like what should be the agenda of the first meeting. So this is also one of the items that should be most probably should be available in the first meeting, that how much amount can be raised by IRP or RP for meeting the requirement of the company. One, for CIRP cost, the cost of professionals, the cost of registered valuers, the cost of expenses. Two, what is the kind of amount required for maintaining the going concern status of the corporate debtor. So if this is the assessment of the IRP, how much money is required along with the consultation, in consultation with the management, and that has to be part of the agenda in the very first meeting. And in the very first meeting, it should be decided that the IRP is empowered to raise this much of finance, and these are the sources which are approved. And this is where the first meeting of the COC should have this kind of agenda.
There is a question, is there any restrictions on the place of the meeting?
No, there is no restriction on the place of the meeting, and you can even have in the conference room of a one of the financial creditor. You can have in your own conference room, in your own office. You can have in any other hotel, restaurant. The only difficulty is, in case there is a person in the COC who requires participation by video conferencing, then the meeting has to take place at a venue where the facility of video conferencing is available. In case there is no person who is interested to participate into the meeting with video conferencing, then you can have meeting anywhere, because that meeting is in person, that meeting is doesn't require video conferencing. So this is the important part while selecting the venue, whether there is any person who actually would participate in the meeting by video conferencing or not. So this is the answer for that.
Actually, there is one query. When a partner of insolvency professional entity is appointed as resolution professional, I think there are some restrictions relating to appointing his partner as registered valuer. So
no, certainly. See,
what are the advantages and disadvantages of being the part of entity and being appointed as an RP?
So the question is like, why IPE should be formed?
Yeah.
What are the advantages of forming IPE as against simple IP standalone? I think right from the beginning of my presentation today, I am saying the difficulty, the first and foremost difficulty is the capacity of your back office. The capacity of your back office actually will be able to determine what kind of cases you would be able to handle. So whenever we are going to any of the customer, whosoever it could be an operational creditor, it could be a financial creditor, it could be a corporate debtor. The customer of a IP is only an applicant or a person who is a financial creditor or a person who is an operational creditor. So the person, every stakeholder is asking, what is the size of your team? How many partners you have? Where is your office and what kind of staff strength that you have, and what are the related experience that you have? So when these kind of questions are being asked, then we have to find answers. Now, you can actually find answers in such a manner that I am a chartered accountant, he is my partner, he is a company secretary, he has got an experience of his own field, I have got an experience of my own field, he is a person who is a lawyer, he has got experience of presenting before the adjudicating authorities. So this is a combination of all that. And then he actually has a back office staff of 20 people, I have 15 people, he's got 20 people. So in total, we have common, so we have collective resources of 60 human resources in the back office, and we are three or four partners. So that is what is our strength. So basically presenting the best foot ahead, presenting your best part ahead of a prospective customer is the need of the hour. Any standalone IP cannot fetch business other than the smaller companies where the operations are small, the number of creditors are small, the number of debtors are small, the number of locations are lesser, the number of properties are lesser. In those cases, yes, a person can handle. But wherever it is a case of larger corporate debtor operations, it has to be a combination of resources, capabilities. So that is what we have done by forming IPE. Although there are restrictions, and the question categorically is targeting, there are restrictions. Yes, we all the partners cannot take up any other assignment from this corporate debtor. But there is a provision, like in case you disclose your interest before the committee of creditors, you disclose that this is the job this we need to be done. And this is the job where we feel that this is the kind of remuneration should be paid. We have an associate concern, which is a chartered accountant or which is a company secretary, or this is a concern with their lawyers. So for some of the assignments, you can actually engage your own associate concerns also, unless your interest is fully disclosed to a committee of creditors. And it is recorded in the minutes that the interest was disclosed and the committee of creditor has taken a thought of decision to appoint a concern which is a related concern of IRP or RP. So that is the kind of possibility, but not, there are certain restrictions which are very clear restrictions. Those restrictions are that none of your partner can actually provide consultancy to any of the members of the committee of creditors. So that is something which is totally off. It is only within the CIRP that you can say that there is an accountancy firm which can be appointed, but then we have an interest in that accountancy firm. Then you can say that this is an associate of ours who actually are doing registration, registered valuers. They are doing valuations, and in case we appoint them, this is our interest into that. This is the description of our interest. So in case the COC can approve, it can still be appointed. But there are certain things which are totally restricted.
I would like to add something in this, because we recently faced one practical problem. In the case of the operational creditor, because we are having as a law firm, so one of the partner would like to become an IRP in the name of Surko, because that is the choice of the operational creditor to propose the name of anyone. So he proposed the name of the one of the partner of the firm, and he would like the all in-kind services from the firm, that only, not only the IRP, you should represent my case before the NCLT or before the authority also. Although there is no such restriction have been written under the law also, in the code or in the rules or regulation, but morally or ethically, if the person who is going to be there, then the corporate debtor said so, that they are having, if the same person is representing as a lawyer and an IP.
No, Hemant, as far as the judges are concerned, in the High Court, in the Supreme Court, there is a concept of independence of a representative. Now, in case there is a representative who is actually representative, is representing his own case in the High Court or in the Supreme Court, it is considered as a clash of interest.
Correct.
So, what the judiciary says that the person who is representing before us, he is representing based on merits. He is not biased on any side of the decision. Even if his argument is accepted or his argument is rejected, it should not be a personal loss to that representative. It should not be a personal loss to the lawyer. So in case there is any decision which actually causes some benefit or some loss to the lawyer, it is considered as a clash of interest. So based on this principle, the adjudicating authority is saying, when you are being appointed as IRP in the application and you are the only person who is representing before adjudicating authority, trying to argue that this application should be accepted, trying to argue that all the documents are available, that is a clash of interest, because in case we reject, that means that it is impacting your personal interest, and in case we accept, it makes you happy personally, not as a professional. As a professional, everyone would like to win a case, win an argument, but as a as a benefit, like if I am getting an appointment as IRP, I will make all possible efforts
to represent
and to the extent of even misrepresenting, with the intention of only getting a result that I would be appointed as an IRP. And I think this is a valid thing to keep away two things. If my own house is on rent and I'm only the lawyer, do High Court or Supreme Court permit you to argue your own case where you are the landlord and you want to evict your tenant?
No, that's true.
Is it possible being a lawyer?
That's true. But the client is client wanting that everything should be in-house. So he said, I am giving you the turnkey project. And if you want to appoint someone from your office as an IRP and you want to represent the case, in that case, I am saying, so being a representing to a corporate debtor for section 10 petition, there is no difficulty.
Yes, yes.
This difficulty comes when you are doing for section 9 or section 7.
Yeah.
Because the allegation from the other side immediately comes that they are representing the same, so they are having the interest there. Although there is no such of a restriction under this, but morally or ethically, what you are saying, that is correct. So therefore, I would like to say is that it's better always to be approached whenever you have been there, so that these kind of means this profession cannot be faced these kind of allegation. I mean to say, for the interim resolution professional who has to be appointed there.
I think by the way, I'm getting reminded of the judgment which actually yesterday. It was a judgment like in the case of application under section 10, it was required by the adjudicating authority. See, one thing I might even tell you, for application under section 10, you are supposed to provide the list of all the operational creditors and financial creditors along with the application.
Correct.
Now, in this case, the adjudicating authority made sure that before your application is accepted, each and every financial creditor and operational creditors has been served a notice. So what I'm trying to present before all the participants is that the application under section 10 is the most difficult application.
Correct.
Because it actually requires lot many documentation. Oh. And the simplest is the application by a financial creditor.
Seven. Yes, correct. I do agree. Yeah. There is no such of a documentation for
yes.
seven. There is, that is proved immediately when you file the
yes,
application.
Yes, yes.
For section 10 application, you need to file so many of documents. It's
yeah.
very difficult to prove. I do agree with you.
So, we were actually continuing with the those actions where the approval of COC is a must. The first I said, the raising of interim finance and also the amount up to which it can be approved in a meeting. Second is, like, the IRP or RP cannot create a security interest on the assets of the corporate debtor without the approval of COC. See, the IRP also cannot change the capital structure of the corporate debtor. It cannot issue additional securities, cannot even create new class of securities, no redemption, no buyback of shares without the approval of COC. See, the even during the course of CIRP, there are possibilities that the ownership interest in any of the assets needs to be changed. For even this, the approval of the committee of creditors is required. See, which is very important is, like, we are normally saying that we will immediately take control over the bank accounts of the corporate debtor, but this also can be done with the approval of COC. So now, coming back to the same question somebody asked, what should be the agenda of the first meeting of COC? So this is also very important, that this should be the agenda of the first meeting of the COC, that up to what transactions the IRP would be authorized to handle a bank account, up to what amount the IRP would be authorized to handle the bank account. So it is not simply by writing a letter to the bank that you take over the bank account. You need an approval from COC. You need an approval from the COC that up to what amount that you can operate. Prior approval of the bank account operations for debit transactions.
Mr. Goyal, just one discussion part of point of view. If the voting share, because you already explained it in your presentation in respect to the voting share, what happened when we are having the pari passu charge as a joint lender, and you are standing with the committee, you are saying, okay, you are passed this resolution, but one of the equally holding footing creditor said, no, I am not standing with you. Like there are joint lenders also, four or five.
So let us understand, Hemant, what is the question? The question is, we are talking about the secured financial creditor, and the secured financial creditors are having charge on one or two assets which are pari passu charge, or even first charge, second charge, let the different charges.
Different.
Now, what decision they have to take? Now, see, first of all, they are different financial creditors. One is one bank, the other is NBFC, the other is a financial institution. So they are independent members of the COC. They have independent outstanding amount of loan as far as their institution is concerned. So pari passu, first charge, second charge, third charge is not meaningful when we actually arrive at the voting share.
Okay.
What is meaningful is the total debt, total financial debt of the corporate debtor, and the total debt due to one member, and this debt should be including interest up to the date of commencement of CIRP. So one amount is the debt, the other amount is the total debt. These are the only two amounts which are required to be seen and used for calculating voting share of a member.
Okay.
Irrespective of the pari passu, irrespective of the first charge, second charge, third charge.
Okay. And if you come into the resolution, suppose, and then this charge equation may come into the picture. Like, of course, at the time of voting share, we have to go by the value of the debt. But suppose for the resolution, and for the resolution, you have to take all the assets of the company into the consideration. And one lender said, yes, I ready to sell at this price. Another said, no, I'm not ready. Then how can, if we, can they voting separately?
No,
because
see,
they should be treated as a separate.
Hemant has asked a very very important question, and I wish that this question, I'm happy that this question has come up, and this question actually is being asked by many people. The question is that if there is one asset, but there are two or three financial creditor, they have a security interest on that asset. Now, in any resolution plan which talks about that asset only, all three have to vote. Unless any resolution plan cannot be approved unless all the three financial creditors who have interest in that particular asset should vote in favor. Even otherwise, let us understand, every resolution plan should have 75% voting share.
Right.
In one situation, that particular asset is having three people who have charge on it, but even the two makes it 75%.
Correct.
So the third is outside.
Outside.
Third is outside. So we are only concerned about 75%.
Right.
So the resolution is passed. The resolution plan is approved.
Correct.
So like, it is very important to understand that whether it is one asset or three financial creditor or a three asset, one financial creditor, it is not really relevant. What is relevant is voting share.
Oh.
It is absolutely this way or this way. It is not at all important. 75% voting share is required for passing a resolution plan, that is required. So in case any action is required for a particular asset, that means that the person, one person is not interested, the other person is interested. In fact, the question comes came to me like this, that the secured asset is there and one creditor says, having two creditors having pari passu charge on a secured asset. One creditor says that I want to opt out and I want to pursue this asset under SARFAESI Act. I don't want to relinquish my rights on this security, on the secured, on the asset into the common hodgepodge. And the other says that I am not interested in enforcing my rights under SARFAESI Act. I am only interested to go with all. So that means the decision of opting out is not acceptable. The decision of opting out is acceptable only in case all the people having charge on that asset vote for means take a decision, because this is not something that to go for voting, because this is an individual action. So both these financial creditor, both the members will actually take collective decisions of opting out or staying in the CIRP process. So this is a different part of the question.
And one more situation like this. In this, all the assets are charged with the guarantors. Company do not have any other any asset. All the assets are with the guarantors. In the time of resolution, of course, because guarantors are not covered under CIRP, you being an IRP not able to take a charge of this. But for the resolution, can we propose to the financial creditor to take those assets also into the kitty and to pay off the debt of the financial creditor? Because the guarantors are the family members of the directors, like once you took a loan from the any banker or the secure, so you have to mortgage your house or land or the collateral has been given by you. So we are willing to settle with the banks and we are ready to dispose of that. But bank said, no, those are covered under SARFAC, so we will go by SARFAC only. We will not put all those assets here. But we want the resolution. So how can, in this situation, the resolution may take place, or is there any?
So now the Hemant has asked a question, like the corporate debtor is not having any important asset and most of the loan is primarily based on a collateral security which is owned by another person. And that another person can be any individual or a relative of a directors or a friend. So that means a loan has been given on another asset, against a security of the other asset to a company, whereas the company doesn't have much of the asset, or the bank feels secured because the residential house already given by the guarantor as a collateral security is having enough value. So the company has gone for CIRP. So in these cases, most of the time the banks will consider, because then that in any case that particular asset is not a part of the assets of the corporate debtor. So the banks have no power to say that this particular asset will actually go into the common hodgepodge. They are not, will be, they cannot be asked whether they are relinquishing their rights or not, because that actually will not form part of the waterfall arrangement under Section 53. That is an outside, that is an asset outside the company. So in this case, in case we, during CIRP, in case we approach financial creditors that we want to sell this house and we want to pay this amount to you, and after making payment to you, the debt will be reduced to 20%, and that will be
beneficial.
That will be paid out of the future cash accruals. So we plan that the company should be allowed to continue, and the company should be given this much of money for meeting the working capital deficit, and this asset will be sold, and this is the resolution plan. So this resolution plan can be accepted, because this will be accepted in such a manner that the promoters will bring this much of amount in the company apparently by sale of the house, and then this the liability will come down, and then the reduced liability would be sustainable. It will be sustainable with the future cash accruals of the company.
Because I propose that in the SARFAC also you do the same thing.
In SARFAC also, like there are possibilities of one-time settlement, there are possibilities of haircut by the banks by taking a waiver. So let us go to the another. See, undertake any related party transaction. And now, undertake any related party transaction can be having two meanings. One, that the transactions with the corporate debtor, with the related party of the corporate debtor. So this is one meaning of this. The second is, undertake any related party transaction means then any transaction that the any party related to RP, any party related to IRP, in case there is any transaction with the corporate debtor. So that also, so I am saying that the both ways it has to take the approval of the COC. Amend any constitutional document of the corporate debtor, in any case the approval of COC is required, delegate its authority to any other person. This is very important. IRP or RP actually will seek approval of committee of creditors when any authority is being delegated. There are various authorities with RP under CIRP, and in case the RP is interested that he will delegate his authority to any other person, that needs an approval of COC. So make any changes in the management of the corporate debtor or its subsidiary, dispose of or permit the disposal of shares of any shareholder in the corporate debtor or their nominees to third parties. So all these are transactions where the approval of COC is required. See, Hemant asked a question like, make any changes in the management of the corporate debtor or its subsidiary. So I replied that it should be presented before the COC before you terminate some of the employees. So that actually tantamounts to change in the management. So it requires the approval of the COC. So you see, you asked this question, so I said even termination also is possible, but it needs COC approval.
Okay.
You cannot see a motor take an approval, termination of all these employees because you...
Okay. I thought that for the interim cost to be reduced because to save the company, so 500 employees are not sufficient, so I would like to seek only 200 because committee comes after 30 days.
Yeah.
So if for 30 days I carried on those burden, so it increased the cost of the interim for the resolution process. So that is only the difficulty practically.
See what I...
Although if I did it something or suspended and then get approval and then finally remove them, but 1 month cost of salary in that issue...
Understand is like all these companies which are actually being, which are approaching adjudicating NCLT or all those creditors which are actually approaching the IBC, invoking IBC. All these companies are running companies or like continuing with this kind of status for a little longer. It is something which is not really possible. It is on the very first default somebody is approaching or invoking IBC. So the way the company is continuing, if it continues for another 1 month, it is really not a very big thing. If a company is continuing for so many years, like 1 month is not a really big time and it will not be really a larger loss. Yeah. So this is also very important that we have a clause number 11.
Transfer. And one more, yes. Relating to, suppose in the being kind of as an IRP, it came to my knowledge that the company did not compliance with the provision of Companies Act and Income Tax by not filing their balance sheet and annual return. And now it is came to my knowledge. And I am the being a IRP, all the control in my hand. So is the duty of the IRP first to maintain or then maintain the record of the company and file it or get it compounded from the NCLT under the provision of the Companies Act or Income Tax?
See,
Tomorrow any liability may fix against me because I have been holding the chair for 30 days.
No, see, during the CIRP period, filing or no filing of ROC returns is not at all the responsibility of IRP or RP.
Okay.
The biggest difficulty is that you need to prepare information memorandum.
Okay.
So when you need to prepare information memorandum, you need balance sheets. Audited balance sheets is one of the requirement of information memorandum.
Right.
Unless the audited balance sheets are available, it is actually not possible to prepare a resolution plan. So it actually becomes a very big duty of the IRP to actually undertake the completion of books of account and preparation of balance sheets and get the accounts audited. I'm not saying that he himself has to do that. I'm saying that he might even engage services of other professional. Now since he has the power, so he can approach directly to the financial institution and banks to get information. He can approach third parties to get information. Even he can also, I'm sure the promoters and the existing management will also give cooperation for completion of all these jobs.
Because for IM, they said you required audited balance sheet, so they did not said ki you required a latest audited balance sheet. They said we have the audited balance sheet of 2014, you prepared it your IM, because it said audited, it does not said so later. So sometimes
there is a requirement under the IM.
Correct.
The first requirement is that it should have the audited balance sheets of the last two financial years.
Correct.
Second requirement is that it should have the provisional balance sheet as on a date not later than 14 days from the commencement date of CIRP. So this is the requirement of information memorandum.
True.
So this is like very updated information is required. So like Lakshmi is telling me that we already have touched the time. So I think
I think CIRP is such an elaborate process. We may require
we actually, this is a series of webinars. The last webinar, the first webinar, we actually covered the basics of this code. This time we actually focused on the formation, constitution of committee, the minutes, the meetings, and the powers of the CIRP agenda, minutes. So this is also very important. So gradually we are also going ahead as the CIRP process itself is. The next duty of an insolvency professional would be to understand information memorandum, and based on the information memorandum, then we will prepare a resolution plan. So the entire CIRP is actually going the way it is actually proceeding. In the country also, presently most of the people who are actually in this profession, they would be facing questions regarding minutes, meetings, COC and powers of COC and the practical difficulties of IRP. So maybe the next week or in next 10 days, the people will start preparing information memorandum. So we will come up with our presentation on information memorandum. Maybe after 10 days, people will start thinking of drafting a resolution plan. Then I will come up with the resolution plan. So this is a complete series on the complete CIRP process. So by the time actually we finish with this, then we actually will think about liquidation. And the liquidation is an entirely different process. And I may even tell you that the claims that we are receiving during CIRP are provisional claims, and we actually have, in the case of liquidation, all the claims will have to be resubmitted, re-verified, redetermined. So this value that we have arrived at for the claims is only for arriving at the voting shares in the COC. The sole purpose is to arrive at voting shares in the COC and also to understand the liquidation value and the total outstanding liabilities for the purpose of preparation of resolution plan. In the case of liquidation, the claims will be separately filed, separately assessed, verified and determined. So Lakshmiji, what is that we have now? We have 2 minutes, so we can actually take up some of the questions.
Yes, in quick session.
What is the purpose of making corporate debtor or
I believe it is already 5 o'clock.
Operational creditor attending the meeting when they cannot participate.
See, like if a total debt of a company, I'm taking forward my own example of 150 crores of debt, and out of the 150 crores of debt, where 100 crore is financial creditors debt and 50 crores are operational creditors debt, if anyone who is actually having an outstanding of 15 crores, at least he has a right to understand what is going inside the COC meetings. He should actually understand what are the kind of resolution plans they are proposing, and he actually would like to participate into any of the resolution plan. He should be a part of the COC, so that he understands that his rights or the operational creditors' rights are also being protected. So this is the reason that, because this, the value is substantial, 15 crore of a creditor. And we are only giving a right to come and see how we are operating. We are only giving a right to inviting him to come and see how we are taking decisions. But that is where he can actually make up his mind whether he is a person who actually to present a resolution plan or not. I mean, most of the time you will see that the most of the operational creditor will come up with a resolution plan. So these kind of operational creditors will come up with a resolution plan who have this much of outstanding. So. Let me take this opportunity of thanking all of you for participation, and we understand that the numbers are increasing on every next webinar that we are doing, and also I may tell you that the last webinar which was held on 20th of April, it was uploaded by IPA of Institute of Company Secretaries of India about 3 days back. And I am very happy to say, that it's in 2 days, there are about 900 views of that video. And this only shows the excitement in the industry regarding this profession, regarding this new law. And then the excitement is all around. Excitement is not only from professionals. Excitement is also from the financial creditors, operational creditors, businessmen, industry people. So this is the kind of excitement. So thank you all of you for participation. I also take an opportunity of thanking Lakshmi. She has actually made efforts, and the entire fraternity of IPA of ICSI and the Institute of Company Secretaries of India for making efforts for spreading awareness regarding this new law in the country, which is considered to be a game-changing law. And also, I am very happy to have a colleague of mine, Hemant Sharma, as one of the speaker here, as one of the panelists here. And the question that he asked is really relevant, is really something which is practical questions. So I thank all of you.
I thank Mr. Goyal and Mr. Hemant. Thank you so much for...
Thank you so much. Thank you so much.
Thank you.